Welcome to Lariat TV News. I'm Danica Young. This week we'll cover a dangerous hoax that took place statewide and possibly nationwide.
And I'm Brady Small. We'll get right back into that story and more. But first, one of Baylor's former presidents has passed away at 76 years old.
Ken Starr, former Baylor president and Solicitor General of the United States, passed away Tuesday from surgery complications. As Baylor's president, he was a lead visionary and pro-futurist in 2012, which was a five-year plan that contributed to Baylor's R1 status today. He held office through the university's sexual assault scandal, which led to his resignation in 2016. He was a prosecutor in the Clinton-Whitewater probe and member of President Trump's impeachment defense team. Baylor President Linda Livingstone said in a statement Tuesday, "Baylor University and the Baylor family expressed our deepest sympathies to Alice Starr and her family. Our prayers remain with them as they mourn the loss of a husband, father, and grandfather."
Waco High School was put on lockdown after a threatening hoax call Tuesday. The FBI is now involved in investigating similar calls elsewhere in Texas as well as at least one other state. LTVN's Danica Young brings you the story.
I just want to know my kid's okay, you know?
Last Tuesday, families rushed to their students at Waco High School after Waco PD responded to one phone call saying there was an active shooter inside with the students.
They went through each individual school or classroom and hallway to make sure that there was no threat. Thankfully, there wasn't, and so now we're just working to get kids back to their parents.
Waco PD went room by room and verified that there was no threat, no shooter, and no gun. They also cleared the building along with all of its students and its teachers.
We were all like really in shock, and we like could see all the cop cars lined up. And I was like, whoa.
Emotions were high at Waco High School today, but everyone is safe and are making their way home just a couple hours after the initial report had been made.
No weapon was located, no suspects were located, so thankfully that was the outcome today.
Three of the current and former Baylor students who are now teachers at Waco High School were present with their students during this lockdown.
I knew it was a risk of being a teacher, but I did not feel like I was going to have to experience that so soon in my teaching career. As a student teacher, that's not really something that you plan on happening while you are in the classroom for the first time.
Other locations include Whitney ISD, Houston Heights High School, Thorns ISD, and Ames ISD. There were also similar incidents at schools in California.
Dangerous situations can sometimes be unavoidable, but this week, Baylor made student safety a priority. Wednesday, students were invited by Baylor's Department of Safety to the Sikkim Safety Event on Fountain Mall, an opportunity to learn tips that may protect students this semester. Activities included a mock dorm room fire demonstration, firefighter challenges, and free t-shirts. The event also hosted Kona Ice, Waco axe throwing, and a dunking booth, and even a bike giveaway.
I got to know things that I didn't know before, like somebody could steal your bike or something like that, yeah. And police officers told me good things about how to keep yourself safe. So it was a fun experience, and I feel more safer, a lot more safer now. Like I have more information about what could go wrong. So,
if you're a student looking for a job or internship, you're in luck, because Baylor's Fall Career Day is just around the corner. Next Wednesday, September 21st, from 2 to 7, you can head over to the Foster Business School for a chance to interact with a record number of nearly 150 businesses from across the country. Before you go, be sure to register through the website Handshake.
Moderna's new COVID-19 booster vaccine is now available for Baylor students, faculty, and staff. The Baylor Health Center just received its first shipment of the new booster. The center is located on the second floor of the Student Life Center and offers appointments on Thursdays and Fridays from 1 to 4:10 p.m.
Pack 100,000 meals in 3 hours. That was the goal of Baylor's second annual Project 5810 food drive. Here's how they got it done. I'm currently in the room where Project 5810 will take place in a few short minutes. And as you can tell, the energy is high. They plan for dozens of students to come and pack food for Waco and McLennan County.
The way the event works is groups of 6 to 7 people are assigned at a table where they are given jobs. They can scoop the food, funnel it into a bag, weigh the bag, and seal the food packages. And once they finish that, it is ready to be boxed and distributed to those in need. Who is it being distributed to? I asked volunteers that very question.
McLennan County has a poverty rate before the pandemic of 26%, and that's only gone up during the pandemic. So we're pushing somewhere around 30% of the poverty rate, which means we have a lot of families in need in this area, and that's where all of these meals are going to go to help support our neighbors in need right here.
It is an event where we bring community members, various parts of campus together to try and address food insecurity in partnership with Caritas.
Yeah, tonight we've got three shifts of people. They'll be coming in, about 150 people at each shift. So you've got some sports groups coming, some civic groups, some fraternities, sororities, faculty groups, student groups, just a collection of friends and neighbors tonight.
Now, as you can tell, all the volunteers have similar t-shirts on. Those t-shirts were donated to them and have the verse Isaiah 58:10 on the back, which the event was named after. If there's one thing I learned from Project 58:10, is that these volunteers love to have fun. For Lariat TV News, I'm Brady Small.
Up next, two unique ways the Waco community remembered 9/11, and a new advertisement for Baylor University, a music video.
One of Baylor's largest student ministry programs has a brand new director, and we'll introduce him to you when we come back.
Let there be light. Let there be roommates and teammates and strangers who become family. Let there be marching and cheering. Let there be challenging courses and time to share. Scholarship and championships. Let there be groundbreaking and soul searching. Let there be laughter. Let there be joy. Let there be light.
On September 11th, 2001, 343 New York City firefighters died fighting the flames in and around the Twin Towers. And a local group decided to honor them one step at a time. LTVN's Katie Kempf tells us how.
The tragedy of 9/11 occurred 21 years ago, and some veterans in the Waco area are honoring those who served by walking the stairs of Jacob's Ladder. 110 flights of stairs. Over 2,000 steps. That's what our first responders were tasked to climb on that unimaginable day. The Heart of Texas Detachment 975 Marine Corps League held its fourth annual Waco Memorial 9/11 stair climb at Jacob's Ladder in Cameron Park, honoring those whose lives were lost during the attacks.
We just want to pay honor and homage to them because, you know, in all honesty, those were true heroes. Those were people who gave up their lives to try to help save other people's lives. And, you know, it's not very often that we get to see what a true hero looks like.
Jacob's Ladder contains 88 steps, while the World Trade Center contained around 2,000 steps. The goal of the climb was to reach 24 relays, but the event achieved far more. The league wants us to never forget, while also spreading awareness on the impact of the attacks present day.
The United States used to recognize Pearl Harbor Day, the day that Pearl Harbor was bombed. So it was an event that people used to not just celebrate, but just to remember. It slowly started to fall off, and then, you know, I myself never recognized or celebrated Pearl Harbor Day, and I said, shoot, man, you know, this is something that happened in my lifetime, and I don't want anybody to forget. I'll keep it going for as long as I can.
Here we are, well, you know, they're going 20th anniversary.
Where Robinson Tower is, all that area, they're going to basketball.
What did we accomplish? Mm-hmm. So my question to you and to everybody else is the war really over? Mm-hmm. I don't think it is, because we still have 22 vets a day killing themselves. We still, if not more, you know, one of my good friends I wear on my wrist, he was a McLennan County Sheriff's Officer here. He was also an Afghan War vet as well, mm-hmm. and he took his life a couple years ago. So honestly, we need to be commemorating this event for Patriots Day, as they're going to relabel it. But what are we going to do about it?
If you or someone you know are in need of help due to suicidal thoughts, please call or text the National Suicide Hotline at 988. For Lariat TV News, I'm Katie Kempf.
Baylor's Army and Air Force ROTC detachments joined forces this past Saturday to host their annual 5K run in remembrance of the men and women who died on 9/11.
More than 75 participants showed up, and although many of them were too young to remember that terrorist attack, current members of Army and Air Force ROTC joined with veterans 21 years later to show how that day impacted their lives.
We carry on the tradition of remembering all the people that have fallen and, you know, making sure the younger generations also remember. I was only 1 year old when 9/11 happened, but it still impacts me today.
Your next semester at Baylor doesn't even have to be in Texas, with old and new study abroad programs. Pearson Lessie discovered some of these programs at the Dr. Pepper Hour.
Dr. Pepper Hour looked a little different this week when study abroad made an appearance throughout the event. Students packed the sub to see all they could, all while enjoying a Dr. Pepper float. There were plenty of booths on display during the short 60 minutes, but what caught people's attention more than the typical pitch to join the abroad program were the experiences that they could potentially have.
People want to have a sense that they are in a place where history happened. And in something as complex and as wide-ranging as World War II in Europe, going to these places makes the history come alive in a way that nothing else can do.
Well, the way that I run it, it's kind of like a family in that we do have sit-down meals together. It's not like the end of the day, goodbye, I'll see you next weekend kind of thing or next week. We're going to be gone for a month and we're going to see each other every day.
Besides the two booths we talked to, there were plenty of other locations for an abundance of majors for students to take part in. When students visited the various booths, they were greeted with a sneak peek of what their trip halfway across the world could look like at the program in the form of things like pamphlets and stickers. If the students that attended were interested in the program, they were able to sign an interest sheet with their name and email. If you were not able to make it to the fair, that doesn't mean you can't find out more on what the study abroad program entails. You can visit bearsabroad.baylor.edu to find out what is coming in the near future. For Lariat TV News, I'm Pearson Lessie.
Vertical Ministries just got a new director, and he's no stranger to Baylor's campus. Caitlin Sides introduces us to the new face of Vertical.
As a believer, and then as a Christian. But it wasn't until Baylor that I understand the full gospel.
Miles Zielinski came to Baylor in 2014 and says his journey at the university helped him find a new love for Christ. He is now back on campus as the new executive director of Vertical Ministries.
So I think he saved me then, but I knew I was saved as a freshman in college because I finally understood the gospel and what that meant.
As a freshman, he didn't want to go to Vertical, but his friends persisted and eventually he started going. Over the next 4 years, Vertical would change his life.
And I was like, dang, I need that. And got involved with Vertical for 4 years. So served there, was a team leader, was the president when I was in school.
After graduating in 2018, Alinsky moved to Frisco, Texas, and served at Watermark Community Church. When former Vertical director Dale Wallace stepped away, Alinsky, who had just gotten engaged, said he had thought about working for Dale, but never thought he would replace him.
We just felt a lot of peace and excitement about Waco. And it was just a really sweet, unique opportunity for me to get to come back to not only a school and a city that I love, but a ministry that means a ton to me.
Alinsky's new plans for Vertical is to keep it the same. And if you would like to see Vertical for yourself, you can check their Instagram for their campus location each Monday at 9 p.m.
We want to be about Jesus. We want to be about the gospel. We want to be about his church. We want to be about seeing people, specifically Baylor students, have their lives transformed by the gospel.
For Lariat TV News, I'm Caitlin Sides.
During the BYU game last weekend, Baylor officially broadcast a commercial with a soundtrack produced by the band Apollo LTD. The commercial showed off what the Baylor community is all about and featured the members of the band as well as Baylor students and staff. It was filmed in 1 day this summer on campus. On ESPN, the clip ran during halftime for only 30 seconds, but the full 3-minute music video can be found on Baylor's YouTube for anyone to enjoy.
There was something just about, you know, what we do that resonated with some of them, you know, coming from a place of hope and joy. We write a lot of music, write a lot of songs about life.
Baylor's School of Music challenged its students in an opera solo competition Wednesday. Some of the school's most accomplished singers battled it out for top spots in next month's opera. LTVN's Jessica Rajkumar has the details.
This past Tuesday, Baylor School of Music introduced its first aria competition, where Baylor undergrad and graduate students perform dramatic solos from classical operas. Baylor's own Dr. Jamie Van Eyck organized the competition with her colleagues to create a more collaborative environment for her music students.
These are unique opportunities, and we're training students to be ready for all kinds of performance situations when they leave Baylor. So it's really exciting to give them a chance to try out this big space, these arias that many of them have been working on for many months, if not years.
Baylor music students work with pianists to prepare their own dramatic rendition of the solo. With distinct expressions and dramatic gestures, each student takes on a character that they must musically execute in order to secure a solo next month with Baylor Symphony Orchestra.
The instrumentalists have like a competition that they do to perform with BSO, so it's fun for us to like be able to work with them too. The only other time we really get to work with BSO is like a Baylor Christmas.
The School of Music invited two-time Grammy Award-winning songwriter Sasha Cook as guest judge.
Everyone was wonderful and really inspiring, so I just want to say congrats to all of you for really a beautiful job.
Who consulted with the competitors after she named the three finalists who expressed their gratitude for the program.
It's an opportunity we see in a lot of places like in the country that really gives us a shot to practice doing the thing.
This is Jessica Rajkumar with Lariat TV News.
In sports, we'll hear the inspiring story of one of Baylor football's most tenured players.
That's right, and we'll also take a look at the volleyball team's opening match of the Baylor Classic. Stick around.
Waking up to another light. No more sorrow and no more night. You're the light. Let it shine now. Let it shine now.
There are many players on the Baylor football team who have great stories of overcoming adversity. LTVN's Braden Murray brings us a shining example of just that.
A standout moment in the home opener against the University of Albany was when 6th receiver Gavin Holmes returned a punt 72 yards for a touchdown.
All that they were punting, the guys were shading right, like they were all feeling right. So he cross-kicked it, so I knew, okay. I knew I was going to have space, you know, and like I said, once I made that first guy miss, you know, I just kind of opened up for me and I did my thing, but it was a really incredible experience.
Holmes tore his ACL in 2017 game versus Texas Tech and tore that same ACL nearly a year later, which forced him to miss most of the 2018 season and all of the 2019 season.
It was like he scored and I was just like, yes, like, you know what I mean? I was lost for words because I knew how much it meant to him. I knew how much it meant to the team. I knew how much it meant to his parents. So it was just like a blessing. It was like a lot of people would have given up, but he didn't. And it was just, oh, I prayed for him after the game because it's like, oh, I was so happy to see him do that.
Fortunately, Gavin was able to start all 9 games in the COVID-shortened 2020 season, but a foot injury sidelined him for the 2021 season.
And mom, you know, she said, I think I should have maybe videotaped you, me. I ran down that breezeway. I mean, I've never been, you know, I get emotional sorry, but just excited about it, you know, just watching that, you know, and it all, he deserved that moment, you know, just proud of him.
Before the game against Albany, Gavin hurt his hamstring, but this time was determined to not let an injury get in the way of the game.
You know, I'll never forget it. It was just fun. I missed it. Missed being in the end zone. This is just special. All my family was there. Just to get the embrace and the love from my teammates and my coaches when I came off it meant the world to me. So,
Gavin and the Bears are back in Waco this weekend as they host Texas State on Saturday. Kickoff is set for 11 a.m. It can be watched on Fox Sports 1. For Lariat TV News, I'm Braden Murray.
After suffering a excruciating 26-20 overtime loss at the hands of BYU last weekend, the Bears hope to rebound and take down Texas State on Saturday at McLean Stadium. Baylor played Texas State last season in a Week 1 matchup, which the Bears won only 29-20. The defense will have to play the first half without Dylan Doyle, a major leader in the linebacker core who got ejected for targeting in the BYU game.
No, I have to be more vocal out there around everyone. I know when Dylan's out there, it's just like, even when I'm trying to be vocal, he's just like, he's right on it. Like, before the formation's even set, he's already knowing what's happening. He's calling it right away, so I just listen, and he sets me up in the best position just to play ball. And with him out, I know I have to talk. I have to do a lot more. I have to step up, communicate more, and just be a better leader on the defense.
Can you imagine deciding on your first 4 year of college before you've even had one day of high school? Well, one student athlete had a special calling to Baylor that she could not ignore. LTVN's Alexandra Lawrence has the story.
That's why the Lord brought me here, was for me to grow my character through the sport of volleyball, but not only that, but also in the classroom, also socially. So I think that coming to Baylor was just an ultimate growth in my faith as a whole.
Freshman right side hitter Allie Check committed to Baylor when she was just 14 years old, and she could have never imagined the character development she would experience on and off the court.
When I was younger, I kind of just played volleyball because I thought it was fun, which I think is great, but I never really knew what it meant to play for something bigger than myself. I kind of just played like, okay, I'm doing well, awesome. If I'm doing bad, not great. But now I know like it's so much more than just me and what I can put out there. It's about the team, it's about the Lord, and I think coming to Baylor, I was able to learn that it's about playing for something bigger than myself.
Allie's volleyball career is nothing short of extraordinary. The 6'4" freshman was ranked the number 32 recruit in the nation for the class of 2022. And she's racked up a lengthy volleyball resume. Even with all these accolades, Allie remembers who she truly is outside of the sport.
God doesn't necessarily pick me to be a volleyball player. He picks me to grow through volleyball, and I think playing volleyball has taught me a lot about my character.
Allie credits her parents, Baylor University, coaches, and teammates who have taught her to not find her identity in volleyball.
Regardless of how I perform on the court, like, the Lord loves me either way. So I think that kind of gives me a sense of, like, comfort when I go out there. It's like, yeah, like, I'm confident in the person I am and the player I am, but at the end of the day, like, the Lord loves me, and that's all that matters. So my stat line doesn't matter, like how well I do doesn't matter, how bad I do doesn't matter, just going out and playing for him.
For Lariat TV News, I'm Alexandra Lawrence.
Volleyball continued its dominant home stretch Thursday night with a sweep over Tulsa. It was the Bears' sixth straight sweep and fifth consecutive win at the Farrell Center this season. Sisters, Kara and Elise McGee led the way, each tallying 12 kills. And Big 12 Rookie of the Week Avery Carlson was responsible for 39 of Baylor's 41 assists in Thursday's contest. Ryan McGuire's squad will finish up two matches on Friday before kicking off Big 12 play on Wednesday against TCU. The Baylor's men's tennis team plays its first match this weekend on the road, while a pair of former Bears are set to play on the world stage. Sports director Joe Pratt tells us more.
When Matias Soto first arrived to the States, he was forced to make a quick adaptation most collegiate tennis players don't have to worry about.
You know, to play in a different surface from South America, and we play on clay the whole year. In college tennis, you play on hardcore, so that's one main thing. I was able to learn how to play on hardcore.
After finishing up four seasons with the Bears, Soto is set to compete in the World Cup of Tennis for a third time.
When I was a kid, I always looked Davis Cup as the main thing that I wanted to do in the future.
Representing from Chile, Soto accumulated a singles record of 80-35 for Baylor and is now the 532nd ranked singles player in the world.
I was lucky to be part of Baylor and compete in the college tennis and live that experience. It was four amazing years, but I was ready to move on and to do, you know, what I wanted to do for such a long time, to be in the professional tour.
For round one of the Davis Cup, Matias Soto and Team Chile will travel north to take on a neighboring rival.
Chile and Peru is like, it's like Baylor and TCU. Like, there is nothing like that. There is a lot of involved in this match. It's not just tennis.
Another former Bear, Adrian Boitan, is competing in the Davis Cup. The Romanian will serve for his country when they face off against Slovakia.
the bigger the stage, the better his tennis is. He really believes in himself and he backs himself under pressure.
The two athletes suit up for their respective squads starting on September 16th. And Michael Woodson hopes his past players' successes will drive his current players to be better and to attract more talented competitors to Baylor.
Most of the guys that we recruit that come and play here, their goal is professional tennis. We have to be able to point to guys that have had success here and then have gone on and done it at the next level.
For Lariat TV News, I'm Joe Pratt.
And that's all for sports this week. We know you've heard it before, but stick with the Lariat for the latest on your favorite athletics.
It's not just sports. We'll keep you updated on all the news you need to know around campus and in Waco.
Until we see you next time, have a great weekend, stay safe, and sic 'em Bears.